Hi, my name is Moritz Lehmann. I'm a theoretical physicist at the University of Bayreuth. I'm currently in the third and last year of my PhD, and I'm very excited to share my work with you today on the Fluidics 3D software that I have written in the last years. This talk is pre-recorded, so feel free to ask any questions. I will be around in the chat, and let's get right into it. So the presentation is about combined scientific CFD simulation and interactive ray tracing with OpenCL. I'll start with a small demonstration. This is a setup of a hydraulic jump. On the left side, there's an inlet, and on the right side, there's an outlet. On the left side, there's also a step where the fluid gets deeper. So when I start the simulation, there's first a wave going from left to right. And then you see the transition towards turbulent flow. And surprise! This is all running in real time on my desktop computer with an NVIDIA Titan XP GPU that doesn't even have ray tracing. So at the same time, while the simulation is running, the GPU is also rendering the simulation data. I can move around the camera and zoom in a bit. The simulation gets a bit slower when I zoom in because the ray tracing is more heavy. And here I show the marching cubes, triangles. I can also visualize the Q criterion, so the turbulence. And I can show you the streamlines. So this is rasterization graphics on top of ray tracing graphics, all at the same time while the simulation is running. I can even do stereoscopic ray tracing. Yeah, I could look at this all day long. I have another demonstration for you. So this is the largest simulation that I can fit in video memory in the 12 gigabytes. The resolution here is 176 million lattice points, so approximately 600 by 600 by 500 lattice points. And this is a 7 mm diameter raindrop impacting a deep pool at terminal velocity and also an oblique impact angle. So in real time, I can still visualize it and move the camera around. And through the magic of video editing, I can speed things up so you don't have to wait a few minutes. So this is the next 9 minutes sped up. And now we're back to real time. So I can move the camera around and look at the simulation results. And zoom in to see the cavity and the crown rim. I can even fly with the camera through the simulation box. And this is all running in real time. Let's look at one of these droplets here. So I can show the flag lattice, so you can get a feeling of the grid resolution. And when I resume the simulation, this is it running in real time. You see this droplet moving through the grid. Here is it with the triangles generated by marching cubes. And the droplet slowly moves through the grid. And of course, with ray tracing graphics, it looks much more nicely than with just rasterization. So let's fly through the box once more. All right, now I guess you all want to know how I pull this off. The basic idea is to do both simulation and graphics with OpenCL. In a traditional approach, you would do the simulation on the GPU, which is very fast, and then you store volumetric frames on the hard disk, for example, the velocity field or the density field. Then you render these volumetric frames with external software afterwards. So in the end, although the simulation alone would be lightning fast, the I/O takes forever and you have to wait weeks for the simulation results to be written to the hard drive, and then you have to wait several days again to get it rendered. The alternative approach is much better and much faster. So it starts with running the simulation on the GPU. Then I also use the GPU to render images from the raw simulation data that resides in video memory. So the GPU already has access to this data and the bandwidth is ultra fast. I only use the I/O to store the rendered images on the hard disk. And this is even fast enough for interactive graphics. So now what happens if the simulation crashes or if you set a parameter wrong and you need to start the entire thing again? You don't have to wait weeks for the simulation results and you don't need to have terabytes of hard drive storage to do it. You can just restart the simulation, look at it with the interactive graphics, and it only takes minutes. Why do I use OpenCL? The main reason is that OpenCL 1.2 runs on any device since around 2012. So it runs on gaming GPUs, it runs on so-called professional GPUs, it runs on data center GPUs, even the Xeon Phi from Intel. It also runs on CPUs if you need more memory. And it even runs on my phone. The first simulation that you saw, the hydraulic jump, I can easily run this on my Samsung Galaxy phone from 3 years ago. It takes a while, but it totally works. Another reason is that there's lots of math and vector functionality already built into OpenCLC, so it's quite a beautiful language to work with. And last but not least, the efficiency is excellent. So on some of the newer GPUs, I actually get 100% efficiency. This includes the NVIDIA A100 and V100, as well as some of the gaming GPUs from the Ampere and Turing generation. Now let's dive into the CFD simulation. How do I do a physically accurate simulation? I use the Lattice-Boltzmann method. So here's some of the velocity sets visualized. In this talk, I will only use the D3Q19 velocity set as this is the most common one, but I have implemented the other ones as well in a modular fashion. The Lattice-Boltzmann method is known to have very high memory demand. On the other hand, on GPUs, the memory is very limited. So to do something about this, I use two tricks. The first one is in-place streaming, which approximately halves the memory consumption and even increases performance a bit because of so-called implicit bounce back boundaries. Another trick that I use is to separate arithmetic position from memory position. So arithmetic position, I always use FP32 or FP64, but for the memory position, I can use 16-bit floating point. And this halves the memory bandwidth, so it almost doubles performance and it also almost halves the memory demand again. I also have a preprint on this currently. Together, these two tricks make the Lattice-Boltzmann method use only 55 bytes per node for standard Lattice-Boltzmann and only 67 bytes per node for free surface Lattice-Boltzmann. To simulate a free surface, I use the volume of fluid model. The surface tension is computed with analytic piecewise linear interface construction. I also have a paper on that one. And I have improved mass conservation from the state-of-the-art method. Let's talk efficiency. So this is the roofline model for the NVIDIA Titan XP GPU. On the y-axis, I plot the floating point performance in teraflops per second, and on the x-axis, a quantity that is called arithmetic intensity. So from the OpenCL code, I generate the PTX assembly, and with a profiler, I measure how many floating point operations and how many bytes of memory transfer are in the kernel. I divide those numbers, the flops divided by the bytes, and then I get the arithmetic intensity. In this roofline diagram, you plot a so-called roofline, which is the limit by the hardware, and then you insert the points of your algorithm. So these are all the small crosses. And the closer the points are to the hardware line, the better is the efficiency of the algorithm. Furthermore, on the left side, where there's the slope in the roofline, the algorithm is bandwidth bound, and on the right side, where the roofline is flat, the algorithm is compute bound. And you see that Lattice-Boltzmann always is in the memory bound scenario. Even if I use some of the spare arithmetic capabilities to do memory compression into custom floating point formats that I have designed specifically for Lattice-Boltzmann. The bottom plot here shows a separate plot for FP64 because the hardware limit on the Titan XP GPU is much lower for FP64. And in the compute limit, we still get peak efficiency. Some of the dots are even above the hardware limit because the boost clocks of the GPU are slightly higher. However, we cannot hit peak bandwidth anymore. As a small remark, the performance plots here were done before I switched to in-play streaming. With in-play streaming, performance is even a few percent higher because of so-called implicit bounce back boundaries that reduce the memory bandwidth. However, memory access efficiency is a bit lower because I have to use misaligned writes. Let's look at some more hardware. So here in the middle, you see the NVIDIA Titan XP with about 90% efficiency for FP32 and FP32 and FP16 mixed position. The NVIDIA A100 with the highest memory bandwidth of 1.5 terabytes per second gets me 8.8 gigalattice updates per second in FP32 and 4.4 gigalattice updates per second in FP64. For most of the other GPUs, efficiency is still excellent, especially for the Turing and Ampere generation. For CPUs, the efficiency is a bit lower because of the cache hierarchy, etc. If you look closely towards the right, there's also the Samsung Mali G72 MP18 GPU from my phone. Performance is very low compared to the high-end GPUs, but it still works, which is quite amazing, I think. As an application, I did a study on microplastic transfer from the ocean surface into the atmosphere by impacting raindrops. So here's a video of a raindrop impacting the water that is contaminated with microplastic particles. And you see that these particles are sucked up into the ground and in the end get into the small droplets that are injected into the air at high speed. In the simulation, I measure all of these droplets, I measure their volume, their speed, and how many particles are inside. And then I do some secondary analysis to see if the droplets can evaporate in the time that they spend in the air. To get sufficient statistical analysis, I did not only a single raindrop impact simulation, but 1600 of these simulations. This is why I need such high performance. If I used any existing code, I would have to wait longer than the duration of my entire PhD for the simulation results. With my code, it was only 1 week of simulation on several GPUs. Now, how to do graphics with OpenCL? This is fun. The message that I want you to take home today is that an image is just an integer array. There's no magic about that. OpenCL can write to an array, so it can render. And you don't need any OpenGL or Vulkan or whatever, just pure OpenCL. For rasterization, so for points, lines, triangles, and circles, I use the Bresnahan algorithm. For ray tracing, it's a bit more complicated with a few more steps. So first, I generate rays from the camera, one ray per pixel. For ray triangle and ray rhombus intersections, I use the Möller-Trombore algorithm. For reflection and refraction, there's Snell's law, and the skybox color is computed with UV mapping. Overall, the entire rendering engine, so rasterization and ray tracing, is about 700 lines of OpenCL code, plus about 300 lines for the custom kernels to render the Lattice-Boltzmann fluid. So it is really not a lot of code. Finally, once the frames are rendered, I can transfer them to the CPU over PCI Express, and then I can either draw them on screen or write them to the hard drive. Now let's look at the choice of the different rendering algorithms and how their performance scales. So Lattice-Boltzmann scales with n to the power of 3, n is the side length of the cubic simulation domain. The number of triangles on the isosurface is approximately n squared. Surface rasterization draws all of these triangles, so it is also approximately n squared. And for ray tracing, there's two different approaches. First one is the bounding volume hierarchy, which itself scales with approximately logarithm of n. However, unfortunately, a fluid surface is moving. So for every new simulation step, you have to redo the entire bounding volume hierarchy tree, and this has to loop over all of the triangles again, which is about n squared. There's a much faster approach than BVH, And this one is called ray grid traversal. And it works because the lattice Boltzmann method already works with a grid. So you can reuse this grid as an acceleration structure for ray tracing. Ray grid traversal scales with only n. So if you blow up the simulation box and make it really large, then you will first run into performance issues with lattice Boltzmann, then with surface rasterization, and lastly with surface ray tracing. However, scaling doesn't tell you everything because there's also a constant for all of these, and the constant is quite large for ray tracing. So typically, the rendering performance for ray tracing is a bit lower than for rasterization. Another benefit of ray grid traversal is that it runs on any hardware at peak performance, not just the RTX and DXR GPUs. I can totally run this on Intel integrated graphics from 5 years ago and it still runs interactively in real time. Now let's look at the ray tracing kernel. So for each pixel on the screen, you shoot one ray out of the camera. If the camera is located outside of the simulation box, you first have to intersect this ray with the bounding box of the simulation box. Then you call a ray grid traversal on this camera ray. If there's no intersection, the ray shoots straight through the simulation box and ends up in the skybox. If there's an intersection, I reflect a reflection ray and refract an internal ray. I call ray grid traversal again on the internal ray and then generate a refracted refraction ray. Then I get the skybox colors of the reflection and the refraction ray. And finally, I mix the colors based on the reflectivity, which depends on the angle of incidence. For water, there's a certain curve. You can model this with a few mathematical functions quite easily. As an optional step, you can repeat the entire procedure with the reflection and refraction ray, so call ray grid traversal on these rays again and compute several reflections and refractions. Now let's look at ray grid traversal, the acceleration structure for ray tracing that makes this all possible. The idea is to only consider grid cells through which the ray traverses. For each traversed grid cell, you first check if the cell contains an isosurface, and if it does so, you generate the triangles with matching cubes on the fly. You then check each of the up to five triangles for intersection with the ray. And if there's an intersection, you compute the isosurface normal on all of the grid points surrounding the cell, and then you interpolate the surface normal to the intersection point. Let's talk optimization. So first, the alignment of the work groups is critical. If you align the work groups as stripes on the bitmap, you will get coalesced access on the bitmap itself. However, performance is not optimal. It is much better to align the work groups as tiles of 8x8 pixels, so you lose coalesced memory access on the bitmap. However, what you gain is that all of the rays are combined into one bundle with a small angle. So it is more likely that all of the rays will traverse through the same grid cells and hit the same triangle, and then you get an effect that is called memory broadcasting. So this is a type of coalescence and it makes the memory access through the grid much faster, and you get overall about 50% performance increase just from aligning the work groups. Another trick that works specifically with lattice Boltzmann is while grid traversing, instead of loading the ISO values, you only load the lattice flags. The lattice flags are 1 byte each, the ISO values are 4 bytes each. The flags alone can already tell you if there might be an interface in the grid cell, and only if there's an interface in the grid cell, then you load the ISO values, and this makes it again about 15% faster. You might also get the idea to load only the new unknown ISO values when traversing into the next grid cell. So for the first cell, you have to load all of the ISO values, and for the next cell, only the new values. You can do this with some lookup table. However, this has a large drawback because the compiler is confused by this memory access through a lookup table, and you lose coalesced memory access. So despite having much less memory access overall, performance is much lower because you don't have coalesced access. So this trick unfortunately doesn't work. How do I generate the triangles? I use the matching cubes implementation from Paul Burg. Here I have visualized all the different triangle cases in the triangle table for you. So you can have between 0 and 5 triangles per grid cell. I did a few optimizations to this already excellent implementation. I reduced the table size overall to only 1/8. So for the edge table, there's some mirror symmetry and I can reduce the data type size to 16-bit integer. And for the triangle table, I can do bit packing and reduce the data type to only 8-bit integer. Furthermore, I compute the cube index in a branchless manner with an unruled loop and bit shifting. And overall, on the right side, you can see the entire marching cubes implementation, which is only about 100 lines of code. What is interesting is that the edge table is not strictly required for the algorithm, so the edge table tells you which of the edges you should interpolate. Moreover, the edge table leads to branching. However, it is actually about 30% faster to use the edge table, even on the GPU, which quite surprised me. And moreover, the tables must be in constant memory space. For the array triangle intersection, I use a branchless version of the Möller-Trombore algorithm. I implemented it for bidirectional intersection, and it returns the distance from the array origin to the intersection point. And here's the algorithm implemented in OpenCL, so it's only 5 lines of code, 2 cross products, and 4 dot products. Now let's make the ray trace surface look very nice. For this, I use normal interpolation. The top image here shows you the triangles as generated by marching cubes and rasterized. The middle image shows ray traced triangles with flat surfaces, and the bottom image shows the surface with interpolated normal vectors. And there you can see all the reflections, and it's all smooth and looking nice. What's funny is that the silhouette of the droplet has still the jagged edges of the triangle. So the two steps here are to calculate the normals on the grid points, and then to do trilinear interpolation to the hit point. The interpolation is only done once after the ray has intersected a triangle, so it comes at almost no additional cost. For the interpolation, I first calculate the normals on the grid points. For this, I use a central difference stencil on the ISO values, and I reuse the ISO values that have already been loaded for the marching cube cell. So I only have to load 24 additional ISO values instead of the full 56. Finally, I do trilinear interpolation to the hit point. For the skybox, I use UV mapping, so this transforms a 3D vector to XY coordinates on an image plane. And then I do bilinear interpolation to get the pixel color. So this wraps the image around at infinite distance, and every ray that hits the skybox then gets a color associated with it. And here's the corresponding OpenCL code for that, so it uses one arc tan 2 and one arc sine. In conclusion, if the simulation itself is lightning fast, but its performance is bottlenecked by PCI Express transfer or input-output, then you have already lost, because then overall the simulation takes weeks or even months. The alternative is to do compute and graphics on the same GPU at the same time, and this is much more efficient and much faster. The one take-home message for you today is that rendering is just another form of compute. If a device can do compute applications, then it can do rendering as well. OpenCL is an incredibly powerful tool. It enables simulations at peak efficiency. Moreover, OpenCL can render faster than anything else if you do it right. And finally, optimization and also micro-optimization adds up. Especially for graphics and ray tracing, every frame counts. And with this, I would like to thank you. Oh no, wait, wait, wait. There was some question by one of the reviewers. The question was, what do you do when you don't have interactive graphics or the simulation takes longer? So here I am in a remote SSH shell logged into the Jülich Supercomputing Center Eureka DC cluster in one of the GPU nodes. So I have a few NVIDIA A100s here. And now let's start the simulation. That's right, interactive graphics in the console. So with keyboard inputs, I can rotate the simulation box and look at it from all angles. The resolution leaves quite a lot to be desired, but it's still better than a black box, and it is sufficient to get a first preview of the simulation. So here you can see these tube shapes of the turbulence from the Q criterion isosurface. And of course, I can even do a ray tracing in the console. Quite mind-blowing, isn't it? All right. So now a very large simulation, again on Jülich Supercomputing Center. This is on one of the login nodes, where they have Nvidia Quadro RTX 8000 graphics cards with 48 gigabytes of video memory. So I can have eye-watering resolution here. This is about 700 million lattice points. This simulation took only 1 hour to simulate and render in 4K resolution with 2x reflection and refraction. The simulation itself was about 25 minutes and the ray tracing 35 minutes. All right, now I really conclude my talk. I would like to thank my supervisor Stefan Geckle for all his support. I'd like to thank all of the people at the SFB Microplastics for the collaborations. I'd like to thank the people from Kronos Group for getting in touch with me and motivating me to do this talk at the conference here. And last but not least, I'd like to thank you, the audience, for your attention. If you have any questions, just post them in the chat. I will be around here for some time. Or write me an email. My email address is on screen. You can also follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @ProjectPhysics. So just get in touch with me, no hesitation. And then thank you again and goodbye.